It is needless to say that like any other ideal, the ideal of celibacy has its own challenges and pitfalls. The following are the things which are important to keep the ideal of celibacy untarnished. The first one is motivation. There is a saying in Sanskrit, Prayojanam anudishyana mandopi pravartate, which means even a stupid person does not do anything unless there is a motive. Practicing celibacy is not simply a matter of keeping one's vow or abiding by the rules of an institution. It is not a question of what one should do. The question is, do I really want to do it? The impulse has to come from within. For that to happen, the practitioner has to be clear about why he is practicing celibacy. In the Vedic tradition, the practice of celibacy is considered a must, even if it is practiced in a graded manner, to transcend our human limitations and to regain our divine identity. The second is spiritual longing. Motivation and hunger go together. I cannot be motivated to eat unless I am hungry for food. I cannot be motivated to study unless I am hungry for knowledge. Similarly, I cannot be motivated to practice celibacy unless I am hungry for spiritual ideal, or in theistic language, I long to commune with God. Burning love for God is the greatest aid in the practice of celibacy. With love of God in the heart, no challenge is too difficult. Without it, every step becomes potentially slippery. Armed with God's grace, we can attain any ideal. Without His grace, we cannot be certain about anything, not even the next moment or the next breath. The third one is detachment. Allurements can come in many guises and from many directions. Unless we look deeply and analyze what is essential and what is non-essential to our lives, we don't know what we must keep and what we need to trash. Wealth and fame, power and possessions may have their utility, but a spiritual seeker learns to deal with them with detachment. Monks in Vedic tradition take a vow and remind themselves about it daily, to renounce the desire for wealth, fame, and sensual enjoyment. This obviously does not apply to non-monastics. What does apply to all is the necessity to arrange our priorities in life, or importance depending on what we perceive as a goal and purpose of our existence. The fourth one is self-restraint. Daily reminders of one's vow would be meaningless unless these are backed up by the lifestyle that is in harmony with one's spiritual ideal. Swami Brahmananda, the first spiritual head of the Ramakrishna monastic order, gave this advice to those who wish to practice brahmacharya. Avoid exciting food, oversleep, overexercise, laziness, bad company, and useless conversation. Hindus have given much thought to the effect food has on the body and mind, even going to the extent of experimenting which food has what effect on us. Accordingly, they have classified certain foods as exciting, which means that too much of their intake stimulates passions and restlessness. They also found that overdoing of anything, be it physical exercise or sleep, is injurious to spiritual life. Hence the advice to practice moderation in everything. The fifth one is higher creativity. Every one of us is endowed with creative energy, and we have the freedom to decide how to express that creativity. In most people, at least a portion of this creative energy gets expressed through sex at the physiological level, but it is possible to express it through other channels such as art, music, and scholarly pursuits. One who wishes to practice brahmacharya must learn to give a higher turn to one's creative energies. This helps to keep mind on the higher plane. To summarize, these are the five factors which are helpful in the practice of celibacy: motivation, spiritual longing, detachment, self-restraint, and higher creativity. The rules and tradition of Vedantic monastic life in particular, and spiritual life in general, have incorporated all these factors to facilitate the practice of brahmacharya.